I want it to be everything to you.
You are everything. You are everything.
Object type, figure, museum number OC1869-1005.1. Title, object, Hoa Hakanhanahe, lost or stolen friend, Moai, ancestor figure. Description, ancestor figure Moai, called Hoa Hakanhanahe, hidden or stolen friend, made of basalt. Images related to the birdman religion, Tangata Manu, birds, vulvas, dance paddles in the form of stylized human figure, a ring and a girdle design are carved in relief on the back of the figure's head and body. Ethnic name, made by Rapa Nui. Date, 1000 to 1200 approximate. Acquisition notes from Wikipedia. Hoa Hakanhanahe is a Moai or Easter Island statue housed in the British Museum in London. It was taken from Orongo, Rapa Nui, Easter Island, in November 1868 by the crew of the British ship HMS Topaz and arrived in England in August 1869. Though relatively small, it is considered to be typical of the island's statue form but distributed by carvings added to the back associated with the island birdman cult. It has been described as a masterpiece, without a doubt the finest example of Easter Island sculpture. Acquisition notes from the British Museum. Collected during the HMS Topaz expedition to Rapa Nui, captained by Powell in 1868, and presented to Queen Victoria by the Lords of the Admiralty. She then gifted it to the British Museum in 1869. Acquisition name. Donated by Lords of Admiralty. Donated by Queen Victoria. Field collection by Comrade Richard Ashmore Powell. Acquisition date, 1869. British Museum collection online. https://goo.gl/OG025L. Object type. Figure. Museum number AM1825-1210.1. Description. Stone figure of the Aztec fire serpent Xiocoatl, with the head of a serpent, short legs finishing in claws and a curved snout. The end of the figure's tail is formed by the conventional Mexican year symbol Zihuitl, a triangle like the solar ray sign, and two entwined trapezes. Culture, period, Aztec. Date, 1300 to 1521. Excavated, find spot. Texcoco, Americas, North America, Mexico, Mexico State, Texcoco. Subjects, pre-Columbian deity. Acquisition name, purchased from Reverend Dr. Buckland. Collection by William Bullock. Acquisition date, 1825. British Museum collection online. https://goo.gl/mu44.
That was super great. That was like great. That was so good. Can you do it one more time? You just do it better.
Because I'm getting a. I just want to sign. My whole night is like gone now.
I know.
Can I have stuff to do, but I'll do it one more time.
Okay.
Sorry,
I'll do the 1, 2, 3, clap again.
1, 2, 3.
Okay.
So, starting five, our point guard was Willie Powers, 6'2", out of Gainesville, Florida. Freshman year, he was like one of the top players in the conference. Number 50, you can see that's pretty much what he looks like, kind of dark skin with bald head. Only thing missing is his headband he wore every game. One of my favorite players, Julian Allen, 6'4", from Connecticut. He was just an all-around great player. He won number 24 because Kobe Bryant was his favorite player. He was really athletic, just crafty, hard-working, never took a playoff. Antonio Hansen, we actually went to the same, we played in the same junior college conference together. He went to Independence, I went to Barton County. So I knew him before I actually signed to Georgia Southern. We talked briefly beforehand, but he was just a lefty shooter. He was like lights out, another crafty guy. Jermaine Pearson, he's from Florida. He was our starting center that year. He was just coming into his game, I guess, like from what I knew about him beforehand, it seemed like his junior year, the games that we played together, he was actually developing, coming to his own. Just a good guy on and off the court. And then me, I think I started after like my third game at Southern. So this was pretty much our starting lineup. Perth Amboy, New Jersey, 6'7", 220 pounds. Athletic, run four, can shoot a little bit, play a little defense. And some of the guys I remember from the team that I recognize from the game as far as like how they have them set up is number 45, that's Kenneth Ward, that was my roommate. Majority of my time at Southern. And we have Anthony Marshall, another Florida guy, super athletic, one of the most athletic people I've ever played with. Number five, we have AJ. He was just a crafty point guard, played hard, could get to the rim, real unselfish, great guy on and off the court. Number 13 was Big Krzysztof. He's a 7-footer from Poland. A lot of battles with him in practice. And I recognize number 12, that's Blake Thompson, another one of my roommates, one of my good friends when I was at Southern. He was a walk-on, he really didn't get to play much, he was hurt, but he was good. He could shoot the ball, lights out. He's a good guy. I spent a lot of time with Blake. And that's pretty much everyone.
What does lights out mean?
Lights out means if he shoots it, he's not missing.
Category A. If the claim administrator determined that you were on the roster of a team that appeared in a qualifying video game, and the jersey number listed on your claim form did not match the video game database for that year, and the game was issued after 2005, then, for that year, you received 1 point in the EA settlement, and 0 points in the NCAA settlement. Category B. If the claim administrator determined that you were on the roster of a team that appeared in a qualifying video game, and the jersey number listed on your claim form did match the video game database for that year, and the game was issued between 2003 to 2005. Then, for that year, you received 1.8 points for each settlement, 3.6 total points. Category C. If the claim administrator determined that you were on the roster of a team that appeared in a qualifying video game, and the jersey number listed on your claim form did match the video game database for that year, and the game was issued between 2005 to 2014. Then, for that year, you received 6.6 points for each settlement, 13.2 total points. 0 points, if the claim administrator determined that you didn't meet the criteria for any of the categories above, you did not qualify as a class member, and you received 0 points for that year.
Wild, right?
Say it's kind of.
In as many days this week may lead to one of the biggest stories in sports history. On Wednesday, the NCAA ended its relationship with EA Sports, whose video games feature avatars that look nearly identical to actual athletes who do not receive a financial cut of the profits. It's an issue that landed the governing body of intercollegiate sports in federal court. Now, as Tom Ferry explains in this Outside the Lines report, the biggest hit to the NCAA may have come Thursday night when a new court filing in that same federal antitrust lawsuit, one that could have huge implications for college sports.
Okay. Hi, Sondra. Welcome. And I'm Connie Butler, the chief curator of The Hammer. Welcome to the audience that we can't see, but thank you for joining us today and agreeing to talk a little bit about It's in the Game. We're so happy to be able to screen it and have it as part of the Hammer collection. We were, as I was telling you, when we were looking at the collection, you know, just during these days and weeks for works that we thought really made sense to highlight and kind of spotlight in this moment, we really thought it was a very obvious choice. It's though we had it on view last year, we really thought that it spoke so beautifully to so many things that, you know, we're facing now as a country. I was thinking and just kind of making notes to myself about, you know, the construction of Black masculinity and the violence done to the images of the body by the media, cultural repatriation, and the current activism around systemic racism in museums, which is amazing. It seems to me it's ahead of its moment, but part of this moment, the video. And also, of course, the really, I think, urgent issue of authorship and who has the agency to tell their own story, which I think is also part of this really interesting personal narrative that you weave into other ideas about the institution of sports, the institution of the museum, and so on. So I thought maybe if you can talk first about kind of how it first came to you to focus the narrative on this personal story, really, of your brother.
Yes, well, thanks, Connie. Thanks for having me today or tonight. So the work started when I found out about the likeness lawsuit against the NCAA and EA Sports. I found out about it through probably like a New York Times article or something like that, and wound up asking my brother if he knew anything about it, and he had signed on to the lawsuit. And it was really amazing because we wound up having like an incredibly long conversation, like, afternoon and tonight, about our college experiences. And I think I'd had a lot of I had a lot of feelings of jealousy for my brother, because he went to school for free and he was playing basketball, and it was such a kind of a cool thing to be doing. And meanwhile, I was like going to art school and paying for everything out of pocket. And I just thought, well, he just has it made. And he did not. His experience in school was in a lot of ways really brutal as a college athlete. We used the story as a bonding mechanism. We just became a lot closer after we were able to talk about what our experiences were in higher education. And that's when I wound up asking him if I could make this work around him. And then it took a couple of years to figure out how the work was going to continue. Like, I knew that there was something to this likeness lawsuit, but it wasn't until I started finding the objects from the Met and the British Museum on websites like Thingiverse and Sketchfab, which are websites that you can make 3D scans of objects around your homes, public sculptures, things like that, and put them online, put Creative Commons licenses on them, and then allow them to be used by the network of people on those sites. And after I found those objects, I started thinking about the similarities between my brother, this likeness lawsuit, the abilities to have control over your image or not, and what these objects were doing, a lot of objects that were looted were doing inside of web spaces where they could be downloaded and completely shifted, changed, morphed into something else through a Creative Commons license. Those two things coming together was really like kind of like the linchpin in the work that allowed it to go into edit and to turn into something that made some type of sense.
Yeah, I see. It's such a poignant sort of mashup of this, this cultural notion of surveillance and, what happens through the licensing really of the images of these bodies, but then also this, I love the moment where he's first in the museum and you're there filming him. It's also this, him coming into your world as well in a certain way, it seems to me, which he's as uncomfortable with as you are, or, as us entering that world of sports, of corporate sports, essentially.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, like, he's been to the Met more than I have. Like, he's totally comfortable in those spaces. But it was really interesting, I thought, about bringing both of us into these spaces that we kind of like lay claim, you know.
Yeah.
The filming in the Met was really interesting. You're not supposed to film in there, but like, thanks to all of the guards who saw us and didn't say anything or helped us navigate through kind of like tougher guards and things like that. Us laying claim to these types of spaces, to me to art spaces and my brother to sports, I thought was an interesting kind of, it was an interesting mashup. To think about how they function similarly. How they can function similarly, yeah.
I saw that in one of the, was it the Village Voice article, one of the pieces on, one of the critical writing about the work mentioned Avatar. I kept thinking of that during the video too, and I kept thinking like, where have I seen that before? And of course, the beginning of the movie Avatar, Michael Jordan is in the Met, right? Sort of similarly looking at the vitrines.
That's Black Panther. Black Panther,
Black
right?
Panther. Yeah. Black Panther.
Yeah. Michael that's P. Right. Jordan. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's the thing about that scene in Black Panther, in the scenes in my video, is that like there's nothing like revolutionary about them, you know. It's like,
yeah,
there are people of color going to those museums all of the time and like asking those questions over and over again. How right. did this stuff get here? How did it get here? How yeah. did it get here? what is this doing here? What does it mean that the placard says a gift from Sir John whoever, what exactly. is that? What is that piece of information, and what does that actually mean? What is the context there?
Yeah.
It's like, it's Black Panther, we all loved it. It was my favorite, it was my favorite yeah. part of the scene, because I think that's like the reaction, taking it down and using it for its purpose is what we all kind of want to do. But even then, there's a fantasy attached to it, because we have no idea, and I specifically don't know where I'm from, what my relationship to those objects are now. Mm-hmm. And so that's the great thing about Hollywood, the fantasy of it, of being able to have that direct connection, relationship, knowing exactly where this came from, and being able to utilize it for the liberation of Black people. That would be grand, yeah.
Yeah, that's the fantasy, I guess, as you say. Talk about the, so in the film, in the video, the computer generated voice that starts kind of listing off those objects or similar objects, you know, the classifications, almost like reading the label copy from the museum wall or something. What was the source for that? And then maybe you can talk a little bit just kind of technically about the different ways that you found those images, because some of the images are kind of constructed digitally and then other things are found too. And then there are the family photographs too, which are the whole beginning part of it.
Yes, there's like a plethora of different types of images revolving in the work. The voice that sounds computer generated is a real person. Uh-huh. that I commissioned to sound really robotic, listing off the names, the acquisition records of objects in mostly the British Museum. So uh-huh. What you're hearing is an acquisition record. Along that, if anyone still wants to watch the video, I have it on my website. You can go check it out. In that part of the work, I've constructed a kind of a 3D space where my brother and his friend Roman are taking still images of my brother's friend Roman is taking still images of him so I could make a 3D model. And the 3D model wasn't used, but the images of Roman taking images of Sandy were used, and that was created in an open source software called Blender. Uh-huh. There was the avatars of my brother were created in a paid software called iClone that allows you to create a pretty accurate face template of someone and then attach that to a body. I have family photos that are blurred out that were taken with like my iPhone that are plastered beneath sculptures from the British Museum and the Met that are in rotation mm-hmm. on top of each other. Lots of different type of imagery. And then the majority of the imagery is footage that my brother and I have took of each other at the British Museum and at the Met.
Mm-hmm. The Temple of Dundur moment is so great. I wanted to say that too. That's so funny, that moment. But you and I were talking earlier about this notion of kind of the way that the images are constructed and then collaged. When I first saw the piece a few years ago, it seemed to me very much part of what we think of as the sort of aesthetics of post-internet, whatever that means. And you and I were talking about how we sort of don't know what that means. But I think what you're describing is that, right? Sort of harnessing these different aspects of digitally constructing images and using them in a very cut and pasted kind of way to make something that's almost visually disjointed a bit, I think. I don't know, maybe you can talk about that, what you were telling me about the post-internet idea earlier.
Yeah, again, still trying to figure out what that is, but I do think that there's something about how the web, how images, not just on the web, but on our computer are constructed. So for instance, like I have a lot of image inside of image happening, lots of layering again, a blurred image of my brother and I as kids, layered on top, and on top of that layered sculptures that are rotating on top of that, like in between that sound happening. Yeah. And I think we were talking about, I was trying to kind of like think about what the geology of a moving image can kind of look like. So thinking about spatially what a moving image can look like linearly, but also moving on the X and Y axis. What happens when an image has a spatial movement that expands its kind of like frame in a way.
I love the geology of the moving image. Yeah. And the music you were saying is really important. The stylistics song, right?
Yes. Yes. Like, so the first time you hear it, it's chopped and screwed. It's technically not chopped and screwed because DJ Screwed did not make it. but it's in honor of him. It's chopped and screwed in honor of DJ Screw. How I make the chopped and screwed sound is by a layering of two tracks on top of each other, like one beat behind or one beat ahead. Uh-huh. And so in thinking about likeness, which really became a word that rotated around, it never disappeared. It was always around this likeness word. I was trying to think about how I could double, quadruple that feeling inside of the video. And one of the ways is by literally doubling the sound by slowing it down, making it in a lot of ways, making it easier to understand and more distorted at the same time. But having both of those tracks on top of each other, referencing each other, talking about like today, I saw somebody body that looked just like you, that doubling wound up being really, really important in the lyrics of the song being that anyway. Today I saw somebody who looked just like you, they walked like you do, I thought it was you. As I turned the corner, I called out your name, I felt so ashamed when it wasn't you. It's all about like a kind of longing to find someone, to find something similar, to find someone who could be the everything, to find that familiarity with someone or something. I think that in going back into the post-internet, post-internet kind of like stuff, but thinking about this kind of like identity creation space that I think is kind of spoken about a lot with that movement or whatever it is. I think for me, I'm trying to find another way of relating. And I think likeness instead of kind of concreteness is the thing that I'm interested in, of what it means to be in relationship to, what it means to be right next to, sliding up against, and yeah. I find my brother, we're twins, and so I also think that the first idea of likeness that we had was each other, growing up with each other, doing everything together, all of those types of things. So as these two gigantic corporations try to use likeness as a way to exploit these players, I'm trying to think of it as a way to relate, just to relate differently, to find something more interesting than exploitation inside of it. Yeah.
I wonder if that notion of sort of slippage or almost misidentification or something has something to do with how you how the work circulates, that you're interested in sort of different modes of presentation of it, but also circulation, that the video lives, it lives on your website, it lives online, it can also be installed in a museum, it also can be realized fully as an installation with the blue, which I'm going to remember the name of in a minute in my notes, but the chroma key blue, with objects too, that so that it in a way kind of always keeps moving, the meaning of it somehow, the reading of it, would you say?
Oh yeah, for sure. Like I think that like the work is of the web space, and that I think that's the case for like a lot of the work that I make. So much of it winds up going back online, in like, which is really important for me in general. Just like having the work accessible, if you want to watch it, you can. It's the context changes when it's inside of a museum that's interesting to me, though. What a museum can kind of bring to the space. You wind up so the work is shown with these objects called workstations. They're Spalding training mechanisms that are kind of like black metal, aluminum metal objects that you can kind of put in any configuration and use as a training mechanism. That being said, my brother had never seen them ever before, so that it's a class thing, I'm pretty sure. If you had like the gym with like the good funding, you would be able to use those.
Right.
But my brother never did, and neither did his friends who'd never seen those before. So the objects in the museum, I think that's really interesting. The chroma key blue wall, which has been following me around forever, as a space to think about blackness inside of the digitally rendered space. I find that interesting, that layering. And I think that the context changes really speaks to the types of images, the types of footage that we're finding in the work. We have the footage that comes straight from we have the objects that come straight from Sketchfab that is outside of the museum is purely server based. The video is now server based on my website, but it also exists in the same place where the objects in those museums that are contested, that have contested histories, also exist. So that's winds up being really interesting to me.
Yeah. Can you just talk a little bit more about the chroma key blue? Because I know you have used it in other works, and maybe not everybody knows sort of exactly how it functions, but also how you're kind of interested in the meaning of it, and in terms of the surveillance of certain kinds of bodies and so on.
Yes, so the chroma keys are a video film. Photo apparatus that allows you to remove the foreground from the background of an image. And what I hear is that the chroma key blue and chroma key green are supposed to be furthest from skin tone. So the chroma keys refuse the body all of the time while also being completely indebted to the body. Like it wants to be around the body so much, but it also refuses it at the same time. the chroma key blue is often used in production that is closer to like darkness, like space, things like that, because of how blue absorbs light. And so blue winds up becoming, for me, blue winds up becoming space, it winds up becoming blackness, it winds up being both spaces at the same time. And so it becomes a social black space of the post-production, the space where we figure out what we're doing, what kind of world we're creating. We're deciding what kind of space that we want to insert. And so it winds up becoming a social space for that to happen. And so that's the reason why I use it in installation. It's a space that like prompts you to make a decision about what you're going to leave in the space and what you're going to take with you.
I want to bring in Aaron Christovale, who's my colleague and an associate curator at The Hammer, who's in the audience, the virtual audience. So maybe Aaron, if you can join us, because it sort of segues really beautifully into a show that Aaron's working on for The Hammer for next year called No Humans Involved, which is the title. Aaron will talk about it more. Aaron's having trouble unmuting, so we'll get her there in just a minute. But the title of the show is based on a Sylvia Winter text that Aaron will talk about, I hope, a little bit.
Yeah, thank you for the intro. Yeah, I mean, first off, I just want to speak about this piece because it was one of the pieces that I feel like we all push for, you know, to acquire. I think it speaks so much to how Blackness is sort of mediated and disseminated in the digital realm. And I think it also just speaks to your ongoing practice, Sondra, of, you know, thinking through different modes of existence. You know, I think Blackness as a notion has always been this contested subject within Western society. And, you know, this exhibition that we're working on together really centers Sylvia Winter's essay, No Humans Involved. And this essay was actually penned in 93 after the 92 uprisings and, you know, after the acquittal of the four policemen in the Rodney King case. And it was really a moment for her as a scholar to think through, you know, this acronym that the LAPD was using, NHI, or No Humans Involved. And so basically it was publicly learned that this term was being used internally in the police department to describe certain cases that were often, you know, Black and brown people, often sex workers or people who are perceived as gang members and, you know, as not human. And so she goes into this really interesting essay and sort of describes, you know, the history of the other, or, you know, Black bodies never be truly being considered human in this society. And so I've just been thinking a lot about this, you know, because I feel like, you know, I'm thinking about the descendants of enslaved Africans and sort of the history in which they were brought to the Americas and, you know, were not considered human until much later. But thinking about how the constructs that we exist in sort of still amplify this notion of being other or not human. So I was just thinking about, you know, for you, like, what are sort of alternative modes of being human? Or is there a potential to exist out of the frame of humanism? I'm thinking about, you know, earlier you were talking about this notion of potentially leaning into the animal, or even thinking about, you know, the machine or the digital realm. And so I'm curious, you know, just sort of, what are these alternative modes of humanism, or can we actually push ourselves outside of that realm?
Yeah, thanks. So nice to have you here, Aaron.
Yeah.
I mean, like, I definitely like thinking about it through the work. Like, a lot of my work with avatars are inside out. So we're going inside of the skin and looking at the innards of like these digital beings that are supposed to be kind of like placeholders for us. And I wonder what that like inside space is, what it means to be turned inside out. Is that still a human being? Is that still a representative for the human? I don't think so. I think it turns into something else. The machine is really interesting to think about because we Black people were often thought of as machinery. So we exist in that space already. I wonder what can be pushed or pulled when we have the ability to do the pushing or pulling. Is that even a possibility? These are all of the questions that I'm thinking through in the studio, in bed at night, when I'm washing my hair, when I'm putting on my shoes. it's all there.
Sondra, I should have said this. I just want to open it up also for questions, that if people want to join us by putting questions into the chat, they will then be texted to me and I will read them to Sondra. And we have a nice question here to maybe start off and pick up on what you were just saying. The question reads, I'm struck by the lyrics of the chorus, "You are everything and everything is you." It makes me think of how often how you often work against the decontextualization and invisibilization of Black bodies, identities in different spaces. Are Black people the you, in quotes, who is everywhere?
Sure.
It's nice.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. I mean, I was thinking, I mean, it's interesting because the you in everything is you can be a perilous space too. You know, having that type of visibility, which we do, which is a hyper visibility, can be wrought with a lot. But I also think that when me and my brother are walking through the Met, I see us everywhere, you know? I do see us everywhere. And there's a sadness there, but there's also kind of a triumph that you can see life inside of spaces that feel like they're the life, the history is being sucked out through the container of the institution. It's amazing to be able to see life still in that space.
Another one that relates actually to the institution. I'm a brown artist working part-time at an arts institution. It's been unsatisfying to see institutions respond to this moment. How do you think we should navigate our relationship to institutions now?
That's a great question.
That's a big question.
That's a great question. I think I'm definitely still trying to figure it out, but I also feel like it hasn't much changed either. I think we all know what's bullshit. We all know what's bullshit. Like, especially if you're working inside of spaces, you know what's bullshit. And I think that your activism is yours. The ways that you want to interact with spaces that can be all for you. I think it's individual, but it's also, I think, the being willing to call what nonsense is nonsense, you know? And at this point, what we're seeing is kind of light coming through cracks of these spaces, to the point where the bullshit is no longer being able to sustain itself. Like, it's actually just like, it's like flaking away, like lead on, like lead paint. And so I'm not like overly optimistic, but I do think that is something that's really important to at least like acknowledge the flaking away.
Another question. Can you talk about when your brother describes his friend's teammates? The audio at the beginning of this part, when you praise him and then ask him to repeat, is also a likeness to tedium of sports practice.
Well, I can talk about that part. It's something I almost cut out actually of the video because I thought it was too stagnant, but I'm so happy I didn't. This is thanks to Alex Klein from the Philadelphia, the ICA in Philadelphia actually. She really helped me kind of like see how important that part of the video was. But it's a, If you listen to it, it's really just like straight up sports talk. Like, it's very like sports one, like, yeah, he's good. He's a good guy on and off the court. Hustles really hard, that type of conversation. But the most important part of that video is that he's recalling them from memory of what they look like based on their avatars. So part of this, part of the lawsuit that he was a part of, was about the likeness inside of the games. So the game that we are playing, I think, is the 2010 version of it, when the likeness of the players was closest to what it could have been, meaning the if a player wore a headband or a sweatband on their arm every game, they were likely to have it in the video game. And that helped the players get more compensation through the lawsuit. So if the game was produced earlier in the run, the technical specs weren't up to snuff, and you would get less money from the lawsuit. If your game came out in 2010, 2019, you were able to make, they were able to make the players closer to the likeness. They're able to make the avatars in the video game closer to the likeness of the players, and you're able to get more money from the lawsuit, which is really kind of just ridiculous in relationship to equity in those situations. But then the conversation that my brother and I are having, he really didn't want to do it. And I wanted him to really bad. And so I begged him, and I tried to butter him up. That's what that was. And I think my brother at first, he said that people were going to think that he was, mean or rude, because he was so despondent or whatever. And I was like, trust me, no, everyone's gonna understand what this is. If they have a sibling, they're gonna understand that it's me bothering you. And every time. It's just a, wow, yeah, you're really like pissing off your brother, huh? So it's cool.
Okay, I just have a couple more. Can you talk about your relationship to the digital space as a medium, which you have a little bit, and how you've embedded you yourself and your practice there over the years?
I don't know. I don't know. I've been really thinking about what it is to be in the digital space, and I'm trying to kind of refigure that for myself. So I don't really have a great answer for it, but I think there's so much potential. I talk about Rafia Santana all of the time. I think that she's an amazing artist, and how she lives in the digital space is fan freaking tastic. A couple of years ago, when I was still on Facebook, she would get kicked off all of the time because racists were calling her output racist, which is absolutely ridiculous. But she would remake all of these profiles on Facebook and with different names, slightly different variations of her name. And it was confusing at first. And then I thought, wow, this is absolutely genius for a platform that requires you to be a stagnant individual in order to steal your data, to steal your identities, to extract from you. She was creating multiples of a self with different information on each profile. I think that that's an amazing way to live in the digital space in order to fuck up algorithms and things like that. For me, I'm still trying to figure that out. I'm no longer on social media. The digital kind of social space is something that I have that is just so incredibly important and has done so much for connectivity. But once again, is the biggest extraction force, one of the biggest forces of extraction happening right now. And it's really dangerous. And so I'm thinking through that. My videos are online. It's one of those things that's one of the simplest things that you could do. You know, it's not revolutionary at this point to have your work in that space, unless it needs like a kind of a serious amount of context or something like that. But yeah, I'm still kind of thinking through it.
Yeah, I think just piggybacking off of that question, do you feel like your relationship with the digital realm has changed during the pandemic? Because, you know, I feel like it has changed for so many people. And A, to your point about, you know, sort of surveillance culture and, you know, basically turning our images into data, I'm thinking about how many new apps we're all, you know, leaning into and signing up for, or even in the, you know, social justice space. You know, I'm thinking about how many emails we're sending out to politicians or how many petitions we're signing on to without necessarily thinking twice about where our information is going. You know, it's been this really interesting thing to mediate, like, you know, how can I be, I don't want to say a digital activist, but, you know, how does activism occur in the digital space? And actually, what are the repercussions of trying to do good work, but, you know, also therein sort of becoming part of a larger data, you know, collection?
Yeah, I mean, those are such freaking fantastic questions. And I think that, like, through the pandemic, I mean, we're on Zoom, like, my whole life. I'm gonna be teaching in the fall. You know, that's my bread and butter. And that's what I'm gonna be doing. Being on Zoom with others, being on Zoom together, you know, being in these digital spaces together, seeing faces, seeing all of these things. I wonder about accessibility to proper internet, like wondering about all of these kids who need devices to learn, who don't have them. I'm thinking about that. And the thing is that, like, you know, like, I the thing that I like admire about activists is that they're using whatever they can. They're using whatever is necessary. And these apps are necessary. These social networks are necessary. And the necessity, I think, kind of outweighs these other things at the moment. But I know that there are thousands upon thousands of people trying to figure this out too. Like, I know they're out there. I just don't know who they are, but they are there. And I'm curious about them. That's where the research for me lies, going ahead, of like finding the people who are doing the work to make sure people are safe, to make sure that these face recognition programs are not going into the hands of police, all of those types of things. Mm-hmm. They're around. They're around and working diligently.
They're just not revealing themselves, which is part of it.
We got one last one from Nikita Gale, who says, with X's and O's, at one point you used the term geology to describe your relationship to video. Can you talk more about that?
Yes. I was just thinking about, like, spatially what an image can do. So I try to think, like, maybe in the same ways that, like painters and sculptors and other image makers are thinking about composing an image. That being said, I'm also thinking about time. So the stylistic song is so important to me because I heard that song before the likeness lawsuit happened, before the song existed, before I did. But it holds the theory that wraps all around the work, which is, today I saw somebody who looked just like you. They talk like you do. They walk like you do. I thought it was you. As I turned the corner, I called out your name. I felt so ashamed when it wasn't you. That's the theoretical base of the entire work. And so When I'm thinking about geology, I'm thinking about the time that it took for that song to reach me when I was five, and how long it took for the story about for the news of the lawsuit to hit me, and then, or to hit my brother, and then to hit me, and then the history of these ancient objects in the museum, when before they were objects in a museum, when they were themselves, and then the transition to object. I'm thinking about the time-space continuum of all of those things being together, and how I can make that clear through the composition of the video, through this spatial relationship. What goes before what, this thing is circulating, so we're seeing in the round. We're seeing behind. It's a blurry image of a family. It's not. It's a circular understanding of how you make 3D rendering images. It's a relationship between a brother and a sister. It's all of these things kind of pushing and pulling each other, like kind of like layers of the earth or something like that.
Yeah, it sounds like a quantum physics. Even when you were describing that, I was thinking about like solar systems and actually like more astrology. It's interesting.
Ooh, I like that.
Are you up for one more? Sure. I find it really interesting that the work has been collected by The Hammer, but it is also available for free on your website. Can you speak about how that undermines perceptions of value?
I could, but honestly, it's just like not a thing for me anymore. It's just... My whole thing in undergrad was I was raised as a video artist by some pretty radical folks who thought that video was the liberation of film. And so the interesting thing about video is that you can make copies of it. It can distribute itself over and over and over again. That was part of the radical potential. So that's how I think about video. The radical potential of part of the radical potential of video is the fact that it can be a multitude of itself. So having my work on my website is just a part of that. And again, it's like, I don't have if I don't want the work up there, it's not up there. But you know, if the work is, most of the time, if it's in a collection or if I'm not embarrassed by it, it's gonna be on my website. That's how I feel. And at this point, again, I just don't think it's of the web. It's of the space. So it deserves to be back inside of that space as well. But it's a great question that I think, thank you actually for asking it, because I think I overthink it. I underthink it at this point, and maybe it is actually interesting that exists. And I understand this is also a question about the commercial art world too. About once something is collected, how the circulation of it closes down. Part of our acquisition conversations. Part of our acquisition conversations with me and Bridget Donahue make sure that my work can stay online.
It's almost as though it shifts the problem from being only yours to being one that the institution has to grapple with too, I think, in a really interesting way. I mean, we had questions about that from our donors and, you know, who we were working with to bring the piece into the collection. You know, they were if this thing lives online, then why are we paying for it? You know, it was really an interesting thing to talk about. And, you know, you can talk about it at the level of just supporting an artist, which I think is completely valid, but also just more as an interesting conceptual problem that the work lives in these different ways. And you're clearly someone who's interested in the museum context and everything that means, you know, how the work can live within it, but also be critical of it, you know, which is more or less what we said when we brought the work in, you know, that it's, yeah, so.
Well, thanks for that. I appreciate it.
Interesting, really interesting question. So we should probably wind up, I guess, Sondra. I was gonna maybe finish, as I told you, by just asking you if you were inclined to say a word about, we've been trying to kind of amplify and shine a light on other organizations, both, you know, in social media and individually, you know, throughout these last weeks. And so we've been asking people to kind of select an organization or two that you've been familiar with and would like to support and would like us to kind of amplify. And you did have one in mind.
Yeah. So I thought of the Poor People's Campaign. And so this is a national organization that has like state specific groups. So I think the cool thing about them is that you can donate to the larger organization, but you can also really get in, you can have your own action inside of a state-specific group that talks about the issues that you're having there. They're fighting systemic racism, poverty, ecological disaster, devastation, economic, the war economy, the prison industrial complex, and again, it's all really specific to the state that you live in. So I think they're a fantastic organization, and they have a focus on working class people.
Thank you. Good. Well, we'll post in the next few days. We'll get out some information about them. That would be great.
Yeah. Awesome.
So I'm so happy you could do this, and we're up for it. Thank you. Really, really thank you for joining us. It's great.
Yeah. Thank you. This is great. It wasn't as like terrifying as I thought. It
Well, maybe you'll come do it again once no humans involved is in our galleries, whenever that is, hopefully soon.
Right.
Thank you so much, Connie. Thank you so much, Erin. And there's like a team of people behind the scenes who just like made this possible. Can we list out some names?
Sure, please. I know who it is on our end.
Yeah. I have them here. I have them here.
Vanessa Arismendi and yes. Claudia Bester and Brian Springer and who else?
Jenny,
of course. Yeah.
Jenny, yes. Thank you all so much for putting this together. This is like the most like supreme pro thing on Zoom that I've ever done.
They are supreme pro. That's right.
That's great.
And also Bridget Donahue on your end and Erin on your end too.
Shout out the Underground Museum.
Underground Museum. Thank you for the LA specific reference. That's so great. Mm-hmm. Very cool. All right. Well, good. Have a good evening. And thanks. We'll talk to you soon.
Thank you guys so much.
Okay.
Thank you, Sondra.
Bye-bye. Bye.